Chuck Bednarik to me is the epitome of what the game of football is all about. I'm talking about the discipline. I'm talking about the toughness. I'm talking about the focus. I'm talking about the intensity. He will go down in history probably as one of the toughest individuals that ever played football.
It was almost as if he was some sort of creation that had come to life and stepped out of a display case in Canton. I mean, it was almost as if everything about him, the way he looked, the way he walked, the way he spoke, the way he played more than anything, was the embodiment of everything you associate with pro football.
He looked like he had been chiseled out of the stone of Mount Rushmore. Craggy face and those huge, huge hands of his. He was a big man among big men. Certain nicknames stick, like Concrete Charlie, because they are perfect caricatures of who that person is.
I've always looked at Chuck as a guy who typified the men who gave this country its backbone. This was a guy who didn't back down from anything. You know, I think a lot of people think, well, athletes today sure had it tough. Believe me, they didn't go off and fight in wars, and they didn't live through depressions. Bednarik was a very special kind of guy.
In Bednarik's era, you came off a field muddy, and there was no one's uniform that was ever dirtier than Chuck Bednarik's. That he played in the center of the game, the center of the line, the center of the defensive action, and his shirt was testament to the game he had played.
He loved to play, he hated to go off the field, so he played 60 minutes, game after game after game.
Toughness, toughness. Toughness is associated with winning a football game. Toughness is pounding that ball until you get a score. When I speak of toughness, I'm talking about Chuck Bednarik.
You're born tough. That's where your linebackers come from. They don't come from the golf course. They don't come from the tennis courts. They don't come from the basketball courts. They're born like that.
A linebacker is an animal. He's like a tiger or a lion that goes after prey. He wants to eat him. He wants to kick the shit out of him. That's a linebacker.
An 8-time All-Pro for the Philadelphia Eagles, Bednarik executed his signature tackle against the Giants in 1960. The victim was Frank Gifford.
When we go back into the game, the defense, Frank's laying on the field. And I looked at him, and I thought he was dead. I mean, his eyes was back in his head, and he was shaking. He was white, and so I said to Mo Gillespie and Greer, and I said, hey, Frank's dead.
He was 75% animal and 25% human being.
If he'd have been with Custer, he'd have been standing right beside him. I mean, that's the way Chuck played the game. That's the way it was.
He would have been great in Spartacus. Absolutely. He could have taken Kurt Douglas's place. Spartacus, babe. You know, sword in his hand and all that jazz. Absolutely. You couldn't be in a lab and mix different portions together and come out with a guy like Chuck Bednarik. If you had a magic wand, you'd want to make 11 Chuck Bednariks.
He was a guy that could dominate a game without ever touching the ball. And there aren't many guys you can say that about.
Like many war veterans returning home, Bednarik was off to college. He enrolled at Penn in 1945 with football 101 on his agenda.
The greatest teams in college football came after World War II. And all these players, a lot of them, were 22, 23. Spring football was easy after fighting Japan and Germany.
Came out for the football team. Here's the University of Pennsylvania. I looked around. I said, what the hell we got here? A bunch of kids. They're 18 and 19. And this toughness within me, I said, that's no problem. I can make this team blindfolded, for heaven's sake. All I had to do was step out on that field. And I just went at them just like we did with every mission. I just, that killer instinct, the killer instinct.
The confidence that he got from those first moments in the locker room, it never escaped him. He always kept that. He always felt that he was the dominant guy.
Chuck was a terror. I remember when he was a freshman, and after a few scrimmages, everybody was scratching their head thinking, who's this guy?
There's an awful lot of tension, or silent tension, right before a big ball game. I can remember seeing that big guy. He was like a caged lion. He'd be walking up and down the locker room, just, you know, let's get out of here. Let's get this thing over with. Just as a kid, that really shook me. I was scared to death.
He would single-handedly demolish another team. We were playing Princeton. He came back to the huddle and said, call 4-3. And 4-3 was a play where he would snap the ball, I would take two steps to the left, and then go straight up off his tail. And he said, I'll open a hole. Well, he opened a hole, I'm telling you. And he put the defensive guy on his tail, and he just came back each time from the end of the play saying, call 4-3 again, and we did.
As the most decorated football player in Penn's history, Bednarik almost won the Heisman, finishing third in 1948.
Chuck basically did that at a time when it was a real glamour era of college football. And here's a guy who's playing center and linebacker from the University of Pennsylvania, because Doak Walker is probably one of the half dozen greatest Heisman winners ever, that you kind of forget how good Chuck Bednarik was.
It's utterly amazing. This is 1948, and other sections of the country looked upon the Ivy League as, you know, a bunch of pretty boys running around. They really did. And for Bednarik, who wasn't a running back or a quarterback, it'd be like the Reform Party winning the White House.
Drafted number one overall by the 1948 NFL champion Eagles, Bednarik was launched on one of the most remarkable careers in pro football history. Bednarik found a home in the NFL. With small contracts and scattered audiences, the players were in it for the love of the game, Bednarik among them.
We had jobs, and when the season was over, then it was work from 8 in the morning to 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
They weren't celebrities off the field in the sense that they were making any commercials, or they had other interests with their brokers. Their game was their whole life.
The game was one tough son of a bitch leaning against another tough son of a bitch, grabbing and scratching and biting and clawing.
There were no holes barred. I mean, there were only four or five officials, and you'd hit a quarterback maybe 3 seconds after he threw the ball.
Such a rough and tumble game seemed the perfect fit for the new medium of television.
Suddenly, the camera loves football because it gets the violence of the collision, and that's what sells it. The camera begins to show you that defensive players with these violent hits are stars as well. And with that, pro football goes rocketing.
And brightest among the new galaxy of defensive stars was Chuck Bednarik, one of the toughest players in the game.
There were players in the league that were afraid of Bednarik. And it takes a very unusual sort of guy to make other pro players wary. They knew that Chuck would do whatever he had to do.
I used to watch the wars between he and Jim Brown. To see Jim go into that line at a tremendous speed and to hear the sound when they hit each other, I saw him shatter Jim Brown. He made it his business to make sure that anyone coming up through his territory, they never forget him.
He was loud and boisterous. He talked a lot, but he backed it up.
He was a monster. We're doing a jumping jack, and he is leading the exercises. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, and he says, hold it. Everybody stopped, and he walks through the line of players and everything, and he goes back, and there's this big guy named Jesse Richardson who weighed over 300 pounds, right? Drills him, and he walks back up front and says, if we're gonna do them, we're gonna do them you screw up a jumping jack, you know? I was scared to death.
Few players ever confronted Bednarik on either side of the ball. But against the Cleveland Browns in 1954, Chuck Knoll made the mistake of putting a hard forearm into Bednarik's mouth.
Next to me is my roommate, Frank Whiteo. I said, hey, Frank. Yeah, Charlie. I said, you see Knoll? He said, yeah. I said, let's get the son of a bitch. Okay. And I remember Groza kicked the ball off, and we went after him. Got him, put him down, kicked him, stomped on him. He got up, frothing from the mouth. You son of a bitch, when this game's over, I'll get you. I'll get you. I'll come after you. I said, I'll be right here when the game's over.
So at the end of the game, he hit Knoll, Chuck Knoll, a shot. And Knoll's helmet went off spinning up in the air like a space shot. And a bunch of the Browns ran over, and they got about 10 feet away. And Chuck just turned and pointed to him, and he said, don't cross that line.
Bednarik's ferocity was a commodity not to be conserved. Well after the two-way player had been replaced by the two-platoon system, the talent-thin Eagles needed Bednarik on the field all the time.
I played in the position, center, where you hit and get hit on every play. I played there as a linebacker, where you hit on every play.
I played offensive tackle 1 year with the Colts. And I hated every play. I didn't like it at all. Not many players would want to do it, particularly when you don't have to.
He ruled that whole back line as a linebacker. And to realize that he had just came from the offensive side over to the defensive side, which means he only got a minute's break, is extraordinary.
Bednarik's durability was the stuff of legend. Missing three games in 14 NFL seasons, he sometimes played when he should have been hospitalized.
He tore his right bicep, so his bicep was literally hanging below his arm.
He goes over to the sidelines. We all go over and are staring at it. He goes like this, works the muscle back up above the elbow, told the doctor, said, put the tape here. The doctor looked at him, put the tape there. Chuck goes, was being held in place. He goes back out. He played the rest of the game. I don't think I ever saw him on a sideline for an injury.
He was a great example to other players. A lot of guys spend a lot of time in the whirlpool. I don't remember ever seeing Bednarik in the whirlpool. Bednarik, he was just an amazing physical specimen.
After helping the Eagles successfully defend their NFL title as a rookie in 1949, Bednarik could not save his team from drifting into a decade of mediocrity, posting only four winning seasons during the 50s.
Chuck Bednarik was 34 years old, playing for a bad football team. I'm tired of the beating and thinking he'd like to retire.
We all wrote that that was it for Chuck, and he got a big ovation from the crowd, of course, and all that, and that was supposed to be it. At the time, I don't think anybody had a clue that Chuck was going to play again in one of the most memorable pro football games played.
When his wife Emma gave birth to their fifth daughter in 1960, Bednarik was financially compelled to return to the Eagles, a team that should not have been any better than the one he quit after the 1959 season. But the mediocrity on paper turned into a winner with Bednarik in the lineup.
The 1960 season, I've always felt, was like a genie that rose up out of a bottle. It granted Philadelphia football fans their every wish for one season. And at the end of that season, the genie went back in the bottle and it was gone.
Everything that ever happened good, everything happened to me in 1960. Everything.
The 1960 team was by no means, in my judgment at least, the best team in the league. And not by any means. But they were the best conditioned. They played hard. And Van Brocklin on offense and Bednarik really keynoted that.
In the fifth game of the season, Bednarik, at 35, was forced to play two ways when linebacker Bob Pellegrini suffered an injury. the move seemed to start something.
It was thought that his days as a linebacker were gone. And when they started to win these games in the fourth quarter, game after game after game, a certain drama was building and carried everybody along, including Bednarik.
With the season winding down, the Eagles found themselves battling for the conference championship against the mighty New York Giants in Yankee Stadium. It was on this stage that the Iron Man would leave his mark.
If Chuck Bednarik was the quintessential steel town product of a linebacker, of a football player, Frank Gifford was the quintessential California product of this unbelievably handsome, great athlete, halfback, wide receiver. And this was almost like a massive collision of two cultures.
I always say this, if you're gonna do anything big, do it in New York.
Leading 17-10 late in the fourth quarter, the Eagles braced for the Giants' last drive.
Chuck kind of drew a circle. And it was like, don't come here. But in this situation, with the Giants having to make the plays and move the ball down the field, they couldn't afford to be selective. So Frank Gifford went to the one place that he shouldn't have gone.
Gifford had no notion that he was coming at him. And it was the type of thing, you looked at it, and you wanted to yell, watch it, Frank!
I have never seen anybody hit anybody the way he did. Nobody.
He just nailed him right around the face with that big arm he had, and Frank was about 5 feet off the ground, and he came right down on his head.
It sounded like a rifle shot. That I remember. I remember that sound, a sickening sound.
The guy who carried him off the field still works for us, Julius Horret, and told me that they brought a priest and gave him the last rites.
Somebody died in the stands of a heart attack. They took the person into the Giant locker room.
So we're undressing, and then out comes this ambulance cart, and there was a body on it, and it was a sheet over.
And I thought it was Frank Gifford. I thought Frank Gifford is dead. You know, Chuck Bednarik has killed him.
And come to find out that it was not Frank. Frank was already gone to the hospital.
Chuck said that he was getting calls all hours of the morning from women from New York, cursing at him, criticizing him, calling him all sorts of names.
I think it probably is the greatest hit in football history because it's a game that decided a conference championship. It's a hit that put the Eagles in the championship game. It was a hit that made one guy a legend forever, Bednarik. And it was a hit that put Gifford out, not only for the rest of that season, but for all of the next season.
December 26th, 1960, the NFL Championship game.
Well, we're gonna have a full house here at Franklin Field this afternoon for this big game between the Western Conference winners, the Green Bay Packers, and the Eastern winners, the Philadelphia Eagles.
At that time, Chuck was at the height of his power. He felt he could do anything, and Chuck somehow sensed that this would be his defining game.
Lombardi was completely obsessed by him. He wrote number 60 on the blackboard and then crossed it out 15 or 20 times to really emphasize, we have got to block Chuck Bednarik or we're not gonna win this game.
Chuck Bednarik is starting at offensive center for Philadelphia, and he will go both ways.
He was the Iron Man. Nobody heard of anybody playing two ways at this stage of football, you know, and yet here he is that in his later stages, not only playing both ways, but playing well both ways.
The game he had against us was one of the special games that's ever been played. He never played a better game than he played against us.
The lasting impression that I have of the game is 21 players trotting onto the field and off the field after every exchange. Chuck Bednarik standing there in the middle of the field waiting for his offense or his defense to come on.
Just about the time you think he's got to be getting tired, he's got to be fading, he's got to be taking shortcuts, Chuck was the same as he was in the first quarter.
With a minute 15 left in the fourth quarter and the Eagles leading 17-13, Green Bay mounted one last drive.
Because it was Green Bay, and because it was a Lombardi team, and because it was Paul Hornung, people were concerned right to the end that maybe Green Bay would find a way to pull us out.
We had got the ball maybe like on our 20, and we'd bing, bang, we're going down the field, we're chewing up yardage, we're moving. There isn't any question about us going in. It's just, you know, when.
Green Bay roaring now, so hang on to your seats, everybody. This championship game is going down to the last final second.
They were on our 16-yard line. There was about 14 seconds left to play. You know they're going to throw the ball.
Starr takes the ball and drops back the pass. He looks.
Taylor swings out, and he flips him this pass. Now he's on his way.
Down to the 15, to the 10, and he drives to the 9.
And then he had to get by me, and I made sure I wrapped my arms around him, and then I threw him to the ground along with a couple of our guys, and I could see the clock in the end zone down to 5. 4, and then it went to 0, and then I looked at him and I said, you can get up now, this end game is over.
And now the Eagles jumping up and down, a happy bunch, the world champion.
It was Hollywood. It was too much to believe you. And I remember to this day, it still remains to me one of the most dramatic moments in all of professional football.
On the field for 139 plays over 58 and a half minutes, Bednarik and the Eagles were NFL champs.
After that game, Chuck said, boy, I feel great. Here's a guy, I looked at him, he had played the whole game. I was so sore, I could barely get in and out of the shower. And here was this giant, and he stood there in that shower and went, wow, it's, you know, it was like something from another time. I thought to myself, there's only one Chuck.
When people talk about the 60-minute man, the Iron Man, I think they kind of vaguely think they understand what that's about. But unless you actually watch that year play out, and you watch the plays that Bednarik made, then you begin to understand that you were watching one of the greatest feats in all of competitive sports.
In the world of heavy steel, that he came from, something that is unbreakable, something that stands forever. Bednarik as a football player will stand forever.